private interpretation of men who were moved by the Holy Spirit. We do have a good crowd this morning. It has filled in a little bit, I think. It looks great. I appreciate each of you being here. John Adam, appreciate the singing. Cooper, our scripture reading. Keith, appreciate the godly prayer. Last week, Jonathan set before us Isaiah 29:13. Inasmuch as these people draw near to me with their thoughts and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the commandment of men. In our relationship with God, we should want to, we should desire, it should be our duty to want to obey God and not man. Jonathan's sermon last week brought back some tough times for me, particularly as an 18-year-old, when really that's when my study of the scripture started, and I was being challenged with those beliefs that I had. Basically, what I found that I had was man creating laws to give cover to what they wanted to believe. Now, we have Bible verses. You know these Bible verses that talk about studying. Acts 17:11, the example that the Bereans who examined the scriptures daily. 2 Timothy 2:15, be diligent to show yourself approved unto God, handling correctly the word of God. Now, of course, I didn't know anything about these two scriptures back when I was an 18-year-old. You know about these two scriptures now. So you should be studying. And that's what I had to do as well. Many times, though, too often, I'm afraid our study consists of what the Hebrew writer calls in Hebrews 5:12-13, the milk of the word and not solid food. Sometimes we hesitate to get into the solid food. Some of us here today, there are several of us here today, as a matter of fact, who have had to do a lot more study than others. If you was raised in the church, you should thank God every day.
Amen.
Those of us who came into the church from the outside, there was a lot of study that we had to do. As I attempted to maneuver through God's word before I became a Christian, it was something that I had never had to endure in my whole life. Had I known my mother had kicked my older brother out of the house, I probably would not have challenged her as much about the Bible. Many of you were probably given a Bible at a young age. I don't know. Y'all were probably given 2 or 3 Bibles as you grew up. You probably didn't think about it at the time. Oh, I got a Bible. That's nice. And you put it down on your desk somewhere. Wow, what a Bible. But I was never given a Bible. Never given a Bible. I was told what to believe, and I believed it. With all my heart, I believed it. After I met Joyce, my wife now of over 50 years. Thank God for what she's done for me. After I met Joyce, I began my study of the Bible. I was informed at the time by a well-meaning individual that the King James Version of the Bible was the Church of Christ Bible. Of course, I know now that the Church of Christ doesn't have an authorized version, okay, that's in use. But I did find out that many individuals use the King James Version of the Bible, and it's a very popular version. And for some reason, I have heard of elderships who require their preachers to use the King James Version of the Bible. This is perplexing to me, really. as one must understand, the force behind the writing, the translation of the King James Version, the Bible was King James I of England, an Anglican. He didn't agree with certain things written in the Geneva Bible, a Bible that was used a lot during this time. There was also things in the a pulpit Bible, the bishop's Bible, a translation that was widely used in the churches. So in 1604, he approved the writing of a new translation, and the Bible, the version of that translation, that was named after King James himself, and that's how come we've got the King James Version of the Bible. It took about 7 years to and 40 people to translate the King James. Now allow me at one point here to, and I'm not casting bad on the King James, I'm just saying the Bible you're using, I want you to make sure that what you're reading is God's Word, all right? And understand that there are certain things in various translations that we probably have to look at, and I want you to be aware of those within the Bibles you've got. But I ask that you turn to Acts 12:4. If you've got a King James Version, and use a King James Version, it will read this. Intending after Easter to bring him out before the people. Now, in most other translations, versions of the Bible, it'll read intending after the Passover to bring him out. Now, that's the only time in the Bible that that word Passover was translated Easter, but it's the same word as Passover there. For some reason, Easter was put in there. Now, folks, the writer of Acts, Luke himself, when he wrote it, he didn't know anything about the word Easter. But he did not write Easter in his writing there in Acts. It was another 200 plus years before this word Easter was even coined. And it was hundreds of years later when this word Easter became being used regularly. So when the translators of the King James Version 1607 got together, Easter was on the, Easter was something they had been used to all of their lives and for many years. So somehow Easter found its way in there. Yet the King James Version of the Bible still accounts for 55% of all Bibles sold. And there are some issues that need to be reconciled. But I want you to be aware, okay, of whatever Bible you use. At the beginning of my study, I had no Bible, okay? The only thing that I used was my family's large white Bible there in the living room called the Catholic edition of the Bible. Now, you may think that the Catholic edition of the Bible would be totally different than the King James Version of the Bible. Or at least when I first started studying, I thought it would be. However, over time, I found out that those two translations, King James and the Catholic edition of the Bible, were exactly the same except for the Apocrypha in the Old Testament of the Catholic edition. Now, I'm sure none of you have the Catholic edition of the Bible with you this morning, but allow me to read what it says there in Matthew 16:19. And you can turn in your Bible, because we're going to look at that next here in just a minute. Again, back to Matthew 16:19. Matthew 16:19. Catholic edition of the Bible reads this: "And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Now, that probably read that way to most of you. I'm not sure. But this is a very critical verse. No, this is a very critical verse within Catholicism. It's the foundation, as a matter of fact. But what about Matthew 16:19 in the King James Version? The King James Version. King James Version reads exactly the same. And I will give unto thee the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Exactly the same. Now, consideration of this verse taken alone, okay, standing alone by itself without considering any other verses within the Bible. Think about what that says. Think about what you just read. Think about me as a 19-year-old reading that. Very clearly it reflected that Jesus told Peter directly, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. In other words, whatever you teach on earth, whatever you and law you enact on earth, whatever you say on earth, whatever you do on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth, whatever law you change, whatever law you decide to get rid of, whatever verse in the Bible you decide to change, it will be loosed in heaven. I believe that then, and folks, there are over 1 billion people in the world today who believe that same thing right now. Peter was given the authority or the key for setting church law. To make, to change, anoint, transmit power to one person who then could transfer that power to another person who could then transfer that power to another person who could then transfer that power to another person. Giving them the right to preach, teach, and do anything that they desired. An example of that was just here 3 or 4 years ago. But that person who had that power, who felt like they had that power, with one sweep of the hand and stroke of the pen, did away with a place that had been believed by those in this religion. That had existed for over 1,000 years, and one sweep of the hand got rid of a place called Limbo, which was a resting place for babies who died without being baptized. But because he felt like he had that power that Peter had passed on down, I'm going to get rid of Limbo. You see, whatever you bind, whatever you loose, that's pretty inclusive there as to what they can do. Considering Matthew 16:19, bedrock verse. At the time, I believe that the religion that I belonged to had the right to do that. Because to me, I could read that verse King James, I can read that verse in the Catholic edition. I could understand what that verse said. Joyce, on the other hand, contended that, you know, no one had the right to change God's word. And to me, that really makes sense. Who? Who in the world would believe that them alone, had the power to change God's law? Now, despite me believing that, I really question in my mind. This really just, who thinks that they are more powerful? Who thinks that they are God, high enough over God to change what he says? That bothered me. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. That was in the back of my mind during all this time. She shared with me her reasoning. She shared with me the other verses of Scripture. And even though I really hadn't studied it enough, I knew that God's word shouldn't contradict with each other. You shouldn't have verses over here that says God's word is to remain changed. Nobody can change God's word. You should obey God's word. Scripture is not a matter of one person's interpretation, but men who were moved by the Holy Spirit. See, I can understand all of that. But then over here, I've got Peter, whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. You see? Boom, boom, boom. later in my study. This thinking was the same beginning about the second century, all right? And this thinking extended without being challenged for over 1,000 years. 1,000 years. This is the issue that led to the whole Protestant Reformation. When in 1517, Martin Luther, who was a Catholic priest at the time, was able to get his hands on the Bible and read it. And he saw for himself that man had introduced a lot of things into God's Word. His nailing of those 95 objections to that church door inspired many others to say, hey, this is what the Bible says, yet this is what I believe and practice. That quickly led to what we call the Protestant Reformation. Within many Bibles probably being used in this building today, no matter how we attempt to explain what Jesus told Peter in Matthew 16:19, even using the verses that talk about not changing God's word, no matter what we do, it seems that we will always come up lacking because of Matthew 16:19. Now we can just choose to overlook this verse. We can just choose to say, okay, we've got the preponderance of the evidence regarding God's word about it not being changed. I don't like that one because lots of denominations out there, you know, list, okay, what does it take to be saved? Okay, look at all the love verses here. We got a million of them over here. Baptism verses, we only have four or five over here, you see. So use the weight. You know, that's not a good way, is it? How many times does God have to say something before he means it, before it makes it a law, you see? We can try to water down that verse. That's not going to do. We'll eventually have to come back to what that verse says. And again, it comes back to Jonathan's lesson last week that inspired me, and that got me to thinking about Jonathan, what I had to go through regarding being taught the commandment of men. However, when I could read in Matthew 16, the actions of my church at the time, the verses within the Bible that Joyce had shared with me really gave me a lot to consider, and I won't be, as a 20-year-old now, or as a 21-year-old now, you talking about heavy on my shoulders, you talking about a heart that would never give me any peace. You're talking about thinking about things when I lay down on the bed, about everything I'd been taught, everything I'd been in the little time I was actually in the seminary, being taught there versus what I'm actually reading in the Bible now. Wow. I had never experienced anything like that before or after. I was facing excommunication from the Catholic Church. There was a wedge of disfellowship from my personal family. There was a condemnation of my soul to Gehenna by the church. But after a long and difficult, arduous journey, which had family and religious consequences, I firmly believed in my heart that no one could change the law of God. No one should be able to change the law of God. And I appreciate Joyce hanging in there with me. Well, as the years went by, I continued my study. I was told by a wise gospel preacher here that to understand a verse in the Bible that you really can't understand, you're having problems understanding it, you know, get the other verses that have a bearing on it and, you know, try to come together on it. Well, I basically almost tried to do that. But there's one verse I want to point out. I've used it before. I love it, but it's Galatians 1:6-9. And it talks about this. It talks about man changing the word of God. But look at Galatians 1:6. Paul says, I am amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel. For for something that was different than I've already told you. You see, this is just what I was facing. Which in really reality, not another, only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. Okay? That's what I was facing. But even though we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to that which we already preached to you, let him be accursed. I understand that. But you see, I still had Matthew 16:19 saying what I felt like it was saying. But I believe that no one should be able to change God's law. And there are many, many other verses that talk about it. And then, as it turned out, what happened to be a hobby for me, I was attempting to find the oldest Bible that I could find. I guess, John Adam, I should have gone over to England and Scotland, and over there I could find a lot more older Bibles, you see, because I was trying to get back to an old Bible that I could really say, okay, this was written before man started changing God's law. And so I spent many hours in antique stores, flea markets, used bookstores, rummage sales, anywhere there was somebody selling something, I went to see if they had any old books for sale. One day in my search, I ran across this book. And you can see I've written in it here. Yeah. That's somebody else that wrote that. But anyway, I found this book for 25 cents. It's Young's literal translation of the Holy Bible. Now, I had never heard of this before. But after I got it, I started researching some on it. And this is the same Young, Robert Young, who wrote Young's Analytical Concordance to the Bible that I had in my library that I had been using for years. And of course, one of the first verses I looked up was Matthew 16:19. Now, a little bit later, an article in Truth for Today by Eddie Clore talked about this. Talked about this translation of Matthew 16:19, which supported the translation of Robert Young here. Over the years, one of Derek's friends became what's called an expert, I guess, in Greek. And this past week, I said, "Hey, son, I want you to do something. I want you to call your friend, and I want you to have him translate that verse for me." Derek came back and said, "It's the same as what's in Young's literal translation of the Bible. When Jesus Christ was on earth, he began delivering a new law." We know that. The New Testament. All right. "However, he only gave us a part of it, and he chose specific men to give it to us." So these specific men were guided by the Holy Spirit to give us the rest of the Bible. He shared his plan in Matthew 16:19 and to others in Matthew 18:18 when he said this. I'm going to read it out of the literal translation of the words as recorded by Young's literal translation of the Bible. Listen now. "Whatever thou mayest bind upon the earth shall be, having been bound in heaven. Whatever thou mayest loose upon the earth shall be, having been loosed in heaven." Now allow me to read from the New American Standard version of the Bible, a version that I've used for many years. "Whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." Yes, American Standard Version. This verse in a literal translation simply states that Peter and other writers of the New Testament would deliver God's word and only God's word. They would deliver the Lord's will and only the Lord's will in their teaching, preaching, and writing. And what they had would deliver, what they had write, what they had teach, had already been decided in heaven, and it was being shared with the writers of the New Testament. The will of God had already been bound in heaven when it was given to the writers of the New Testament. Whatever the will of God was as far as having been loosed, had already been loosed in heaven. This verse does not teach that Peter or anybody has the right to change God's law. Scripture is not a matter of one's own personal interpretation, but men who are moved by the Holy Spirit. The understanding that Peter did not have the power to change or enact or loose laws caused Matthew 16:19 to mesh very much with all of these other verses of Scripture talking about nobody changing the law of God. Now I want you to think about this for just a minute. Just, it won't take long, just a second. Even Jesus Christ himself did not have the power to enact God's law. Even Jesus Christ, the Son of God, did not have the power to enact, to change, to loose, to create God's law. Why in the world would anybody think that mere mortal man could change God's law if the Son of God couldn't change it himself? Heaven informs earth. Earth does not inform heaven. The Creator informs the created, not the created informing the Creator. The proper translation of this verse lifted a huge burden from me. A huge burden. And it's my prayer that more within the world will come to an understanding of exactly what Jesus said. There is no verse in the Bible that gives man the right to change God's law. However, you can understand the politics within the churches regarding this verse and a few other verses. If a particular religious group uses this verse to give them the power to do what they do, why would they have any inkling or any desire to even look at changing the translation of this verse? Why wouldn't you? Wouldn't even consider it. But in reality, we must teach what the Bible teaches. We must not teach what man teaches. As Jonathan said, men are being moved by the commandments of men and not God. And that is wrong. That is sinful. What about you this morning? Have you obeyed God or have you obeyed man? Which is a good place to start, as y'all heard me before, is the last thing that Jesus said before he ascended into heaven. Go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them all that I have commanded you. Very, very simple command. But folks, man has changed that. Sinful. I want you to obey God and not man. If for any reason we're happy this morning, let it be made known now while we stand.
Just that I am with thy.
comes forward this morning saying that, acknowledging that he has been living in sin. And that over that time he has attempted to justify that sin, but he says he can't justify doing something against God. That's what the church is about. It's helping each other. It's reaching out. It's to understanding. It's to showing how much we love each other. And that we don't want anyone to be living in sin. Having to be, to justify, rather than sharing with others to help. And I'm glad, I thank God that Bill came to the realization that he needs to get this taken care of. Let's pray together, please. Father, we do love you so much. Father, we see that love for us in the sacrifice of your Son. Father, we acknowledge that was a hard, hard thing to do. And Father, looking at that, we should realize the love that you do have for us. That the love that we should have for you, Father, being displayed in our obedience to you and not to man. And also displaying our love for you in our conduct and in our actions and in our thoughts. That all of these things, Father, follow your will. That are in accordance with your will. Father, we thank you for Bill this morning. Acknowledging that he wants to get rid of this sin that's in his life and he wants to do better. And Father, we know that you will forgive him. We know that Father, you will place him on the right track. And we ask, Father, that you help him as he continues to walk along this path after you. Father, help him realize the love that you have for him and the kinship that we have with him. And Father, that we would help him and that he would help us and that we could all help one another. Forgive him, help him, forgive us, Father, as we fail. Help us all, Father, This incomparable, intense affection for us.
Let us pray for the bread. Merciful God, Holy Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this day. Father, we're so thankful for your Son and his great sacrifice. We're thankful for this bread, which represents his broken body on that cruel cross of Calvary. Father, may we all take it in a manner pleasing in thy sight. In Jesus' name.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, just thank you for this cup. Thank you for what it represents. Please help us as we take of this cup. Please help us think back on that day, think back on that sacrifice that was made, and please help us be able to really comprehend what this cup really represents, and that is Christ's blood that was shed on that cruel cross. And just please help those that take of this cup, take of it in a manner that will be well pleasing in my sight. In your blessed name.
Supper now being concluded, we had the opportunity to take up the collection of the saints. Let's pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, we come to you giving thanks for this opportunity now that we have to reflect upon this past week, reflect upon the bounty of it, Father, and we pray now that each of us have set aside the first fruits of our labor. Father, we do realize that through the sin of man, man's prosperity would come from the sweat of his brow. Father, we pray that each of us have worked diligently this past week to provide for ourselves, to provide for our families, and foremost, Father, to provide for the church. We pray now that each of us get back and get back to the man that's pleasing our son. In the Son of Jesus Christ, and we pray.
Translator of God's word ever set out to confuse anybody or to even trick anyone. But they are men. And sometimes their thoughts, unbiased, they can only be unbiased so far before when they read God's word and they put it in paper, what they think about it comes out of their pen. It's just a flaw of man. It's the difference between God and man. So keep that in mind. And also, I always had the King James just out of familiarity, and I still do. It's still my favorite. But I also have learned that there are other good ones out there, too. So I always thought that was just the worst thing to be able to be here anywhere else but the King James. But it's got its weaknesses, too, believe it or not. So appreciate that lesson. That verse, 16:19, in Matthew's always been one. It kind of, you can study Tolan pretty easy if you don't want to take it in context. So I appreciate that good understanding. Appreciate everybody being here this morning. We've had a cold weekend, wild weather, but it's beautiful today. Is there any announcements that need to be made? If not, let's all stand. We'll sing the second verse of number 248, and we'll be dismissed in a closing prayer. Don't forget, leave your birthday gifts out on the table in the foyer. Okay? 248, second verse.